Hi, I'm Carrie Byron from Mythbusters, and you're watching the whole podcast.
Welcome to the whole. I am Rob Sprantz.
I'm Franco Del Valle.
I'm Laura Levine.
And we are joined by Aaron Augenblick from Augenblick Studios. You know Aaron, his animation has been in so many different things. Ugly Americans, Wonder Showzen, Losers, which I just saw on Netflix, which was fantastic. Superjail, Jellies, I could go on and on and on. He's another New Yorker as well, which, you know, three of us are all from New York, as you could tell from our accents, Aaron. So we're actually really happy to have you on. Welcome.
It's great to be here, Rob. Is this part of the game? Am I supposed to guess the one person not from New York? There's one person here. Franco? Is that true?
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I was born in Peru. So wow. I'm like, at this point, I would consider myself a Peruvian, or rather an American, but I don't know.
Wait,
I'm a New Yorker.
My studio has been, this year is our 21st anniversary, always in Brooklyn, New York.
Very cool.
Proud to be in Brooklyn.
Yeah, very cool. It's good.
You're from Delaware, like a certain president-elect, right?
How did you know that I was from Delaware? I've done everything in my career to hide that fact. But now Delaware's all over the news. I can't believe every time I watch CNN, they're in Delaware. It's the most insane thing. But yes, I grew up in Wilmington, Delaware, and then I went to New York when I was pretty young for college. I went to School of Visual Arts in Manhattan, and I've been here ever since.
Very cool. Well, I want to get into all of that, and especially how you got to where you are, because it is a very cool story. And you know, there's so many people who want to do what you do that never get to that point. And you know, it's very impressive. And I want to start with, you have a new show coming to Netflix called Headspace's Guide to Meditation. Okay. Now Netflix was nice enough to give us a 2-episode screener of it. And it is very, very cool. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know if it was one of your comedies, you know, disguised with a game. I wasn't sure what it was. And as I'm watching it, it literally is a guide to meditation.
Yep.
And the animation in it, and I'm going to play the trailer in a second just so people can get an idea, but it's out now. You can go to Netflix right now and watch it. I strongly recommend you do, because as somebody like me who always heard about meditation and never thought I could do it or thought it would be even remotely something that my mind could handle, because I wander like crazy, you know. So sometimes I read a book and I'll be going through the pages and realize that I stopped paying attention 4 pages ago because I'm thinking about it.
Yeah.
But this is actually a guide that takes you through it. And the animation is such a huge part of it. So I'm going to play the trailer real quick and then we'll come back and talk about it.
Great.
When was the last time that you did nothing? And by nothing, I really mean nothing. Hi, I'm Andy, and welcome to Headspace Guide to Meditation. Throughout this series, I'm going to be your guide as we explore the mind and discover how meditation can benefit us in our life. In each episode, I'm going to introduce a new technique and tell you how that technique can be used for specific situations. I hope meditation can bring you a greater sense of presence in your life, a greater ability to not be distracted, to enjoy life and to connect with the people that you care about most. The best way of experiencing meditation is to actually do it, not to just talk about it. We're going to start with the eyes open and a nice soft focus, just aware of the space around you. And just take a moment before you do anything else, just to appreciate and enjoy that feeling of having stopped.
That is so very cool.
Does everyone feel more calm now just by watching that? It should. You should.
I did. And I did like about, you know, I wasn't sure if it was, like I mentioned, like I don't know what I was getting into when I was watching it. And then when it got to the part where it was actually having you do the exercises,
yeah,
I just started doing it. And I was like, oh, this is really cool. But the animation is beautiful. And it's simple but yet beautiful at the same time. Definitely different than other some of your other work, for sure.
Yeah, look, I'm really proud of this. This is, you know, a very groundbreaking show, I feel like. And, you know, I have to say, you know, we are one of four animation studios that made this show. Vox was the production company, and they did a really interesting experimental thing by animating the show in the way that they did, in which they basically approached it almost like an anthology, where they had a number of episodes and they split them up amongst four different animation companies. And then every company was told to interpret the visuals in their own studio signature style, right? So we were approaching this, you know, almost like an experimental film, because what we were doing was we were trying to visualize consciousness and meditation and the idea of sleep and all these, like, you know, big broad concepts that often aren't visualized. So we were really reinventing the way we approach animation, because for us, it's typically comedy, right? It's like our goal is to engage viewers and shock viewers. We tend to do, you know, adult, like, late night comedy. So, you know, we were trying to almost do the opposite of what we would typically do, which is wake everyone up and, like, make everyone laugh and freak everyone out, right? So in this, and it was funny, when we did our kickoff with the team at Vox, they said, they were like, yeah, we're you know, we're all big fans. We really want to see what you do with this, but we are a little nervous about your company because, you know, there's not much about you that feels very meditative, right? Like, most of your work is very funny and violent and surreal and psychedelic, but there's not much that, like, makes you want to, like, you know, calm down. So we were like, no, we can do this, you know. So, you know, we really approached this, you know, a lot of it was thinking in terms of, like, fine art. A lot of our inspiration for this came from, you know, impressionists like Miro and Matisse and, you know, people like that, that were sort of illustrating ideas in a more conceptual way than a literal narrative way. So we just dove headfirst into it, and we just really wanted to do justice to, you know, the Headspace brand, which is already a really beautiful visuals that they've created for Headspace. So we took that as sort of our jumping off point. And then, you know, we got the audio from Andy, who's the head of Headspace, and he's the voice of Headspace, Andy Puddicombe. And he would give us these narratives, and then we were just illustrating them as best as we could. So it was sort of a balance between, we wanted to be really beautiful, we wanted to be interesting to look at, but we didn't want to not be meditative, right? So it was always at a certain level, you know what I mean? We always did all of our animation, the colors are very subdued, the visuals are very slow. Even if you're talking about, like, a concept like stress, you don't want to be too stressful, you know what I mean? Because you want people to watch this and calm down and feel more mindful. So it was really like not much that we've done before. So I'm very proud of the work that we did.
Yeah, and you should, because there's, especially the animation that happens when, like, you know, without giving anything away, you know, it for each episode, they kind of tell you what the focus is going to be. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it sets you up and discusses it a little bit before you get into the meditation, doesn't just start. But the animation for the meditation part goes along just with the breathing and everything. Right. Like, you see, and
very flowy.
Yeah, like,
it's extremely flowy.
And as calming as his voice is, like, I feel like if you watched it without the sound, you would still get that feeling. And that's got to be kind of what you go for most of the time in general with what you do.
There's almost, you know, we did four, you know, 20-minute episodes. So, you know, almost every episode, there's not one cut. We tried to keep every, and that includes the meditations, because there's, as you'll see, if you watch it on Netflix, you'll see that there's sections to every episode. There's stories, background about the concept of meditation. There's physical techniques on how to meditate. There's the science of meditation, what's happening to your brain when you're actually meditating, which leads to, like you pointed out, Rob, the actual meditation, where you can actually sit down in front of your screen, whether that's a phone or a TV, and meditate for 10 minutes, right? So all of that, there's not, we try to have every single segment seamlessly blend into the next one. A lot of that came from our animation director, Devin Clark, and he really pushed the idea of it being like a free flowing, like stream of ideas that you're seeing all the way through. So I think that helped as well with feeling meditative.
Yeah, and you can see it. I'm definitely going to try it. Like, I really do.
Yeah.
This inspired me to try it and see if.
Yeah.
Well, I know living in Manhattan, there's these huge places with like that, no, like, you know, hundreds of people come and do TM, which are all closed now because of the pandemic.
Sure.
And so I think this is like, the timing is so perfect for this to come out.
Yeah, no, I mean, we started this at the beginning of the year. And we're already delivering. We literally delivered last week. You know, Netflix wanted to produce this for people. People have never been more stressed out, right? I mean, the world is really stressed out right now. So it was important to them to get this into people's screens as soon as possible. So, you know, like I said, you know, we only started working this at the beginning of the year. Usually there's much more buildup. There's much more time that goes into it. But, you know, everyone really cared a lot about this project. Everyone in my studio, everyone at Fox, everyone at Headspace, everyone at Netflix. It was a real labor of love, and we knew how important it was for people to see it. So I'm happy that, you know, on January 1st, it's ready to be watched.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you can go to, go ahead, Franco, you had something to say?
Oh, yeah, I was going to say, if I could paint a picture, I had just finished watching Die Hard, and so we're watching John McClane like pull glass out of his like feet, and you know, we're really, really hyped, and then I'm like, oh, Headspace. And then Kara's like, are we watching a Headspace video? And I'm like, oh, I guess we are. Right. I didn't know what to expect, because I'd never like associated the brand and like put it together. And she's like, yeah, I've done a bunch of their exercises in the past. And so we go from like this crazy, like, you know, super like exposed like movie to all of a sudden something really calming, and I'm like, oh, okay, I guess this is what we're doing before we go to bed, and I slept really well.
It's great. It's really beneficial, and like Lori, like you said, it's like it's nice to have something you know, this accessible you know, for all of us. And look, I'm a meditator myself, and I, you know, I find meditation important in my life, and you know, I definitely it was a real thrill to be able to, you know, illustrate these types of concepts, because it's simple. I mean, it is a really simple thing, and you'll see on the show, there's nothing, you know, crazy about it. It's not a religious experience. It's all about being mindful of the moment that you're in, and, you know, being aware of your breath, and you know, basically just calming down, and it really, it's very, very beneficial. And I like to be able to have my animation in a part of something like Headspace. It's really been an honor.
I gotta say, it's been so crazy. Like, I feel like in the past year, since the pandemic, like every single thing I've seen has been so, there's been so much stimulation and everything. It's just been like pandemic movies. Like,
oh,
the week that it went like into lockdown, everybody's like, have you watched 28 Days Later? I'm like, not in 10 years, but I guess now's the time. So it's been a lot of like really stressful stimulus. And then to have this on the back end of a really crappy year, I think is just exactly what the doctor ordered.
Well, you know, life is a cornucopia. And I, you know, if I'm not, you know, watching Headspace, I'm watching like the gnarliest horror that I can find. So I, you know, exactly. I like a little bit of everything, because there's been some great horror this year as well.
Yeah. Well, I really want to take some time to dive into some of the other work that your studios have done and kind of how you've gotten to this point. But once again, just remind everybody, Headspace Guide to Meditation. You can check it out on Netflix right now. Just go get calm, get meditative, and you really, really will enjoy it.
It's good as a hangover cure as well, I will say, because it is New Year's Day, possibly. We all had a good time last night, and you know, meditation is great for hangovers.
And that's what's in your coffee right now.
Oh, there's a lot in my coffee right now.
Well, yes, that does bring me to your other work, because clearly it's a lot. There's a lot more here to explore.
Aaron, so. I was reading that when you were in school, you started working for MTV on Daria.
I did. Yeah, that was so my first job in animation. Thank you. Yeah, I'm proud of that. I mean, I went to SVA. And I did a thesis film there that MTV saw and they liked, And so I pretty quickly, I was lucky enough right out of school to get a job at MTV. And I, you know, obviously I started at the bottom doing photocopies and assisting people, and managed to work my way up to work on Daria, which was really exciting. And it was so cool to be a part of that show. And I was at MTV for a couple of years, and kind of got a sense early on that, is although like I met a lot of my favorite people there, and I got to work in animation and see how animation gets made on a larger scale in a way I had never seen before, I pretty quickly realized, like, you know, I'm kind of an indie guy, and I knew that, like, the corporate world wasn't for me as much. So within 2 years, I started my studio. So I graduated in, I think, like late 90s, like 97, and I started my studio in 99. So, but a lot of what I learned at Daria, things that I use to this day.
Was The Wire the film that you did?
The Wire was my second year film, but I think my second year film was better than my thesis film, because it's the one that people seem to still talk about. There's been some weird fandom about my second year film, The Wire, on Lost Media Wiki. So people got kind of obsessed with this kind of obscure movie. But so I did The Wire. My thesis film was called The Midnight Carnival. And then the first film I finished at my studio was called Ramblin' Man.
Mm-hmm. So then when you... How did MTV recognize you? Do you send it to them? Do they just see it? I mean, there's not crazy internet then like there is now. I mean, it's around. I'm starting to date myself.
This was festival days. This was like, you know, you would finish your film and just like put it in the mail to every festival you could find. And I was lucky enough to get into a lot of festivals, and I won a couple of awards. And I think that's how MTV found me.
It's very cool. So when you work for Wonder Showzen, because that's your first, after Daria, you started getting involved in that one. And yeah, that's, you know, I kind of, I did a binge on it, on a lot of the episodes and a lot of it beforehand. And I'm laughing like crazy, but I think that show has a lot of what a lot of your future shows have, and that's you're afraid to push the envelope.
Yeah.
Afraid to use it to communicate on social and current issues, but at the same time, just really funny. Really.
Yeah. That's great. You point that out. And I think, starting out with the studio, we started with no money. We've never had any real investors. We've just been just working. And it was just like from one small job to another small job, and always doing, you know, a lot of independent films and getting those seen. And our first show was actually a show called Shorties Watching Shorties that was on Comedy Central. And that was like a stand-up comedy show. We did that with Dennis Leary's production company. And so that was the first show we did. And then, you know, shortly after that, you know, Vernon Chapman and John Lee and Allison Levy, they have a production company called PFR, and they did Wonder Showzen and Archie Holler and Xavier Renegade Angel and all these great shows. So, but at the time they were doing their first show, which was this show called Kids Show at the time. And it was, you know, this bizarro nihilist acid trip of Sesame Street. And they were looking for somebody to do animation, because like Sesame Street, you got to have the animated segments. And we met and we hit it off. And I agree with you that I think that's the first show that we did that felt like a sea change for the studio. It was like, this is the type of work we're good at. This is what we excel at. This is where my tastes lie. My tastes obviously lie more in, you know, indie film and, you know, more surrealist and psychedelic and, you know, horror and all that kind of world, more than I think mainstream like kids cartoons and what most companies make all their money at. So early on, being a part of Wonder Shows it was really important for me in the studio. And I think it definitely helped create our brand. And I think it's some people associated us with Wonder Shows to this day. Wonder Showzen is coming out on Blu-ray, and they're putting it on the complete season, and they're putting it on streaming. It's now for the first time, and there's gonna be all these extras and everything. So we just designed the whole packaging, so that's coming out pretty soon. So you'll be psyched.
I that is super exciting because obviously the only way to watch it now is to pirate it somewhere.
Exactly. Yeah. Both seasons are all in one package. It's really cool. And the cover is really insane. What do you see?
I can't wait to see it.
It literally will make you vomit. It's that disturbing.
That's
I don't know. Again, I think MTV wasn't paying attention. They asked us to design it. We designed this thing with a little girl, but she's like bleeding out of her face and there's eyeballs in her hair. And we made the most disturbing image and they're like, that's fine. Send us your invoice.
They're so busy with teenage mom. They're like, whatever.
I mean, honestly, like I think one of the episodes that freaked me out the most, because I was like, I must have been like 14 when I started watching that show, 15 or something like that.
Yeah.
It's like Mother Nature's sex change, where like the whole world starts like vomiting because it's just like it was insane.
Or like, I almost mentioned it, but I was like, maybe it's a little too fucking weird for this thing. But like, you know, because you were saying like, it was really, I don't know if it could be now. We did a thing on that show where we had Trevor was the little kid that would interview people. He dressed up as Hitler. And he went to the World Trade Center, and this was right after 9/11. We were doing that show right after 9/11. He was at like the rubble of the World Trade Center interviewing people. What's your funniest joke?
Oh my God.
Oh, I mean, even when he would
just, I mean, you could never do that now.
Yeah.
No.
When you would like ask the pig, like, you know, what's it like to like work for the police department.
Oh, that the dead pig, right? At the butcher shop.
Or like, I forget the little girl's name, but when she goes to Wall Street and starts asking all the people like how they live with themselves, like knowing that they're like ruining the world.
Who did you exploit today? I think was
They were genuinely, when we were making that, they were genuinely like trying to subvert things. Like they were like sneaking all kinds of secret messages and like hidden. They would put a frame in here and there. They were doing a lot of stuff. There was that one episode, do you remember that one, Franco, where they did the backwards?
Yeah.
That was heavy. They did, you probably guys haven't seen it because it's a deep dive, but like we did an entire episode that was backwards. But then halfway through the episode, it plays the backwards part forwards and it was like an anagram, you know, like, what is that? Like Anna nabbed me a banana. It was like the same backwards and forwards. It was a mind fuck. Like it was really crazy.
I think the one that confused me the most was like the horse apples episode. Like the Freelander and stuff like that. I was like, what the fuck? Like even for that show, I was like, what am I watching?
We had there was a lot of people on that show. There was a lot of people. Yeah. John Glazer was on there and Will Oldham. And
wasn't Amy Sedaris in a couple?
Amy Sedaris was on that. There's a lot of famous people. I'm trying to remember, but I think Stephen Colbert used to be sneaking into stuff, but look, John and Vernon, like they really laugh at like Southern, like red state people.
Oh, the Bush episode was amazing.
That was them like doing like Hee Haw, you know, that show.
Hee Haw. Well, red
that was them doing like, yeah, they were like, let's laugh at like Hee Haw people.
So it was really dark.
It was super dark.
Like there's that joke where the woman's like, it's like, what is it? Like the beats me joke about like the husband.
Oh yeah.
It's like mom beats me too. And it's like, just like the worst humor. I was like, oh my God, what am I watching?
Yeah. It was like, they were just like, let's take the most disturbing things, say them, and then put a laugh track behind it. And then it becomes a comedy. Right. Oh yeah. Maria Bamford was on that too. Maria Bamford was awesome. So
was that the episode where like the country is like basically George W. Bush and like, he's just like, we're changing up the entire, like we're changing the script. Like we're all going to be Southern now.
It's so insane to think that like we were all so angry that George W. Bush was the president. You know what I mean? Now that we've been through Trump, it's like everyone's like, "Oh, he's so cute. He does his paintings. He's such a sweetheart." And mad at Bush back then.
Yeah, look at him. Look at him respecting democracy.
The worst thing he does now is like no Ellen DeGeneres. Like that's the worst thing he does.
Right?
Now is like hanging out with Ellen DeGeneres. It's really crazy. I mean, that's probably the first thing I can remember watching that kind of shook my worldview.
Yeah. Because
it was extremely humorous. It was super dark, but also just like examined everything from like, I don't know, like Israeli-Palestinian like conflict to, you know, like the meat factories in like Omaha, Nebraska or what have you. Like it was really, really wild. I'd never experienced anything like it. And like I went to a small art school in New York. And it was the same thing. It's just like everybody who was in the video program were in doing the fine arts thing. Like that was a show that they talked about. That was a big inspiration for them. To what extent, like my current political and like social beliefs, like I think I owe a lot to you guys. So
that's
I don't know.
I appreciate that. That's huge. That's great. You know, a lot of people, you know, come to me and say the first time I took acid was watching your cartoons on Wonder Showzen, and I'm very proud of that. With Wonder Showzen, I have a theory. I think it's the most anarchist show that's been on television, at least in the top three. I know that, you know, John and Vernon had a mission to really turn TV upside down. And I learned a really important thing from John and Vernon, which is because obviously, like, they're incredibly independently minded. And, you know, they could be out, you know, in a cave somewhere creating some, you know, doomsday device, right? But instead, they were working for Viacom, right? And I remember asking them about that, and they said, oh, you can do so much more damage inside the system than you could ever do outside, right? And honestly, like, I took that as a lesson that I think about to this day. You know, it's like, we've always been, you know, working for networks and corporate, you know, corporate entities, but trying to sort of, you know, invert things from the inside is part of what we do.
Yeah. I mean, it's really crazy to think that show was on MTV. It was mostly on MTV too, but like, yeah, it still was
right,
like, still there. And that to me was insane, like, just because you're taking on everybody on that show, right? Like, it's just a little bit of everyone getting like their fair share of like criticism. Yeah.
A lot of, you know, what we get away with is when people aren't paying attention. So I would tend to make like cult hits, right? And therefore we can get away with things. So yeah, Wonder Showzen, it was like, I think we, like, our lead in was like the Andy Milonakis show at, like, you know, I don't know what time o'clock.
It was like,
and it was on MTV2, which was new at the time. And there was like a couple people at MTV that were into it. And otherwise they were putting it on and people were just finding it on their own. It was completely word of mouth. They couldn't have done any less promotion on that show. So
it was really wild because everyone I knew watched it. But to bring up the point of acid, which we've earlier discussed, it's like a really fun thing. One of the first things that I watched and talked about this was Metropolis. It was one of the first movies I ever, but I also saw Superjail, which is another show that you guys worked on.
Right.
That was something that I watched on an acid trip. And I think I just was in a good place because that could have ended really poorly.
Yeah. There's a trajectory to Superjail that, you know, the end is always hyper violent. So hopefully maybe you went and did something else at that point.
I ate salami. Yeah. So it was okay.
Well, it wasn't the last acid trip, so it obviously went well.
Superjail came shortly after Wonder Showzen, actually. And that was created by a good friend of mine, Christy Caracas, who I had met in like the indie film circuit. And he had this show, he had conceived as a jail show hosted by Willy Wonka, right? So it was like, could we take this, like, the humor of like hardcore hyperviolence, but then, you know, accent it with like psychedelic candy coated cartooniness, right? And you know, that was a fun one because it was just like from the ground floor we wanted to make, you know, a really funny, hyper violent, extremely cartoony show, and I think we achieved that. So it's a fun one.
You did. It's insane. Like, I grew up watching The State too, that's the show, and then obviously David Wayne being on the show, you know, as the warden. It was just so, it's just, you recognize the voice and you're like, holy shit, it's you. But it's the show was just in, like, we would just sit down on Sundays because that's when it would premiere. It'd be like Sunday at like 11 or something like that, and just sit down and like, didn't think like years later we'd be talking about it.
Yeah. That was fun. I mean, Superjail was like, I think like maybe six or seven people sitting in my studio around a table trying to make each other laugh, right? It was like, what's the craziest things that we can do. And honestly, you know, the people you have to thank is Adult Swim, because a show like Superjail could, like MTV, I feel like Wonder Showzen existed because people weren't paying attention, right? Adult Swim, they pay attention and they allow artists and creators to have creative freedom, which is extremely rare in mainstream television. And, you know, the fact that Adult Swim was supportive of us and like understood what we were going for was really meaningful, you know, and I've had a great relationship with Adult Swim for a long time now, because, you know, not think of a network that would do a show like Superjail, Tim and Eric, Mr. Pickles, Rick and Morty. I mean, these are really daring shows. Do you know what I mean?
They're pretty out there. Yeah.
Really out there. And not a lot of people would take a chance on shows like that. So look, we were like, let's make a really crazy show. And Adult Swim said, okay, go for it. And we did. So.
And even like the evolution of Adult Swim, where it started with like, you know, Space Goes Coast to Coast. And then it like moved on from there.
Yeah.
Where it just became like, you could see anything from ridiculous like live action to Xavier Renegade Angel, which is like one of the strangest shows I've ever seen in my life. Like a man with like horse legs backwards and like snakes for arms, like it was just I just don't understand like what I was watching half the time. But it also, you know, I think has shaped the generation for like the past like I would say 10 to 15 years now.
Yeah, it's funny. It's like some people are Wonder Showzen people. There's people that are Xavier people. We didn't work on Xavier. We did a couple things for Xavier. We just a little animation for them, but that was a whole CGI thing. We don't really do CGI, just because it's not my taste. I mean, one of the things about my studio is, you know, I've always seen us as a creator-driven studio. We're not really a production company as much as we're a creator studio. So, you know, if something isn't something that I particularly like, we tend not to do it, right? So, you know, we don't really dip into CGI. We don't dip too much into kid stuff, you know, unless it's extremely interesting to us. And, you know, we've been able to maintain that through the years. So we didn't actually do Xavier, but you know, I don't know if you want to talk about it now, but I'm excited because we're reuniting with the PFR team this year on a new show called Teenage Euthanasia that's also going to be on Adult Swim. And that's a really exciting show. It's about a mother and daughter that run a funeral home. And the mother, I don't actually think I could say that much about it, but the mother may or may not be undead. And we star Maria Bamford and Joe Firestone and Tim Robinson and just a lot of really, really hilarious people. B.B. Newworth, super, super amazing cast, super funny show. Definitely takes the nihilism, the darkness, the independent spirit of PFR and all the things that you love. But I think it's actually going to be a new side that you're going to see of Adult Swim and Augenblick Studios and PFR, because there's a lot of really meaningful relationships. It's obviously hugely funny, but it's going to have a little bit of a family comedy feel to it, which is really interesting experiment for us.
Yeah,
it's the other crazy. Oh, sorry about that.
That's okay. So here's one thing that I would love to know. And you know, so you mentioned you started your studio. You started this around the time of Wonder Showzen. Did you start it? So was the Jellies the first one that your studio did? Like, when did you start that studio?
So it's, you got it upside down. So the first thing we did was Shorties Watch Shorties. Then we did Wonder Showzen. So these were early. These were like the early 2000s. We didn't do Jellies. So that Jellies was a show we did with Tyler, the Creator. For Adult Swim, we did two seasons of that, and that was only a few years ago. So we did, we just wrapped the last season about a year ago. I think that was in 2019. Mm-hmm. So that was actually one of the more recent things we did. But in there was Superjail. We also did Ugly Americans. There's a lot of different shows.
So when you have, you mentioned this new show and you mentioned the story and everything that goes with that. So I would love to look at the process a little bit, because this is the part that really fascinates me on how it all comes together. Do you kind of simultaneously work on the visuals and what the story will be at the same time? Or do you pretty much get the story and the voice acting ahead of time and then work and paint the picture around that?
Typically, you lead with story. The first thing that's going to come is obviously the concept. You know, you're going to conceive of a show, whether it's something the studio comes up with ourselves or whether it's something that somebody comes to us with, like PFR. So the first thing is the concept. You talk a lot about the concept. Does it have legs? Is this like something that is funny that you could do a lot of episodes out of? Then usually you start a treatment, you start writing about the characters. What are they like? What do they do? What's their backstory? What are some different episode ideas that we could go? You want to talk about an arc. Generally, you want to do something, not much that we do is purely episodic. You want to have some sort of arc going on. But I think before we start animating, you're going to have a script. So we typically start with some sort of script. at that point, you know, you have the you know who the characters are, you know what the show is about. That's the point when you start saying, okay, now we know what this show is. Let's visualize it in the best possible way we can. And that's honestly my favorite part of the entire process, because, you know, every show is different and you have to treat every show, you know, in its own way. If your company is just a machine and you just crank it through the machine, you know, there's subtleties to, you know, Superjail is a very different show than, say, you know, Wonder Showzen or Teenage Euthanasia. They all have their own reasons why they're funny, right? So you can ruin a joke by visualizing it in the wrong way, right? That's the worst thing you want to do, right? So honestly, like early on, you're figuring out, like, what does the show look like? How does it feel? Is it really cartoony? Maybe like with Ugly Americans, we went kind of realistic because it was important to the comedy that it felt like the actual New York City. It didn't feel like a cartoonified New York City. It was important to us that it felt like this is New York if, you know, creatures and demons and monsters lived amongst us. So for a comedy like that, you know, it felt like, okay, we're going a little bit more real with this stuff. So let's visualize it that way. So, you know, early on you're figuring out how to visualize it, and then it goes off from there. Then you start designing the characters, you start designing the locations, you storyboard, you're animating, you know, and that's pretty much the process without getting too boring.
Yeah, but everything is hand-drawn though. So mm-hmm. This is not... obviously, we know you don't do CGI. You made that clear, and you can tell because it's well done.
Yeah.
The way it looks is like, you know, some of the favorite animations that we grew up with, just in a more advanced look to it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, how does that process work? Is it literally frame by frame? Do you start with the hand drawings and use some computer to kind of facilitate it a little quicker? That's part that just so totally fascinates me, how that gets
started. Everything we do is hand drawn, and that's literally a hand with a pen drawing. We don't use paper or you know, pencils. Everything we're doing is typically on a Cintiq tablet, you know, which is those tablets where you draw right on the screen. So, you know, what we do is, you know, like, I'm a big fan of animation history. I love, you know, old cartoons from Betty Boop, Popeye, Warner Brothers cartoons. I mean, that's my favorite stuff, right? Mm. And a lot of what I do is taking the way that they've made animation, you know, for 100 years and just doing it in the most modern way I can do it. But still the aesthetics, the approach, the visual comedy is you know, going to be evolved from, you know, the things that Tex Avery was doing. Right, the things that the Fleischer brothers was doing. Like, we're trying to evolve that and tell the new stories, you know, with that process. So, you know, what we're doing is everyone's hand drawing. They're drawing, you know, keyframes and in-betweens and paths of action and all the traditional animation techniques. It just so happens that we're doing them on a Cintiq tablet. We're using programs to do that. Usually we tend to center around the Adobe suite. And you know, we're using programs, we're doing it in an expedited way, but it all boils down to drawings. I mean, that's what we do. Animation is drawings. It's funny drawings, drawing things as funny or as interesting as you can possibly draw them. So it's not something where you type in an algorithm of like, okay, you know, here's a squirrel and he lives in outer space and, you know, whatever. And so, like, it's not that. So what we're doing is we're literally drawing, and, you know, there's some bells and whistles. There's some things that you can do, you know, within the programs that can, you know, make things easier for sure. But generally it's hand-drawn keyframes, hand-drawn in-betweens, hand-drawn traditional animation.
And it's gorgeous, you know.
Thank you.
It is. And it does have that old school. You mentioned, like, some of it, it reminds me of the animation of some of the cartoons when I come home from school, but
yeah,
at the same time, far more advanced with brighter colors. And of course, the subject matter is way darker.
Definitely. Like, you know, it's like I'm inspired by all of those classic animations, like I said, Fleischer and Warner Brothers and Disney. But, you know, another important influence on myself and my studio is underground comics. I'm a big fan of comics, and specifically underground comics. So, you know, I was extremely inspired by, you know, Robert Crumb and Daniel Klaus and Chris Ware and Peter Bagg and, you know, all these amazing cartoonists that, you know, had a very indie sensibility, right? So that's another important thing. You know, I still to this day, I'm just like looking for any independent vision in comics and cartoons and movies. And, you know, all those things sort of come together, I think, to become the style of our studio. You know what I mean? Because like you said, it's like, it's kind of like classic cartoons, but it's kind of new and it's kind of messed up and it's, you know what I mean? And it's really funny, but it's also dark. And that's just because it's those are the things that I tend to like, and it just all sort of comes out in the animation.
Yeah, I was thinking of the Hebro from Wonder Showzen, which was right out of He-Man, you know? And it's that same similar... I mean, your animation is far more advanced than those, because I didn't feel like that cranked out pretty quickly, those cartoons. You know?
Look, you know, that was something I learned on Wonder Showzen, and, you know, when you do parody, you know, which we do a lot of parody, you know, you got to commit. Like, you got to commit. Like, it's like, I'm a fan of, like Young Frankenstein. Oh. Right. It's like, you know, Mel Brooks was like, I'm going to make a parody of Frankenstein and it's going to look just like Frankenstein.
Right.
He got it all the way down to the film stock and the sound quality and the music. And man, does that make it funnier to me. Like, that's what I love. You know what I mean? I love Young Frankenstein. I love Spinal Tap, you know, movies where it's like, it looks just like what they're parodying, right? So when we did Wonder Showzen, you know, they started throwing us all these curveballs. It was like, oh, can you draw like He-Man? Can you draw, you know, the Care Bears? You know, can you do G.I. Joe? You know, all these like oddball, you know, things. And it's do your homework. You know what I mean? People ask us like, oh, how do you do that stuff? And it's like, you got to do your homework. It's like, you got to take those shows, right? He-Man, we sat down and watched those frame by frame, trying to deconstruct how they made those things, right? All kinds of discoveries you make, you know, you're seeing the cell shadow and like, oh, they would like, a lot of those shows, they were kind of like, you know, factory made. So they would, you know, they wouldn't even be careful about the quality of the art. It would get dirt on it. There would be like smudges on screen, you know, so you put the dirt on it, the dust is on there and the dirt, and the, you know, there was like, you know, all kinds of like weird things that you would find, you know, the acrylic painted backgrounds and, you know, all these different things. These rotoscoping and reusing, like all these things, we would discover these, like how they were making them. And we would try to recreate them as close as we possibly could. The color palette was always really important too. So, you know, all those things, you know, with Wonder Showzen, it's like the research is half the battle for sure.
Yeah, makes sense. So now I would love to talk about Ugly Americans a bit because, you know, that's probably the first time I was exposed to your work a lot more and more, more frequently. It's, you know, again, the concept of New York and, you know, you mentioned if New York was infested with demons and there, it kind of is.
If.
It kind of is already. And, you know, is this at the time that you did this, now this was for Comedy Central and it wasn't really a part of Adult Swim. It was more of just a straight up comedy show, right?
Yeah. It's a little more mainstream. Yeah.
Yeah, so is this the first like full blown show that's all yours at this point?
Superjail was the first, but we only did one season of Superjail, and then that led into Ugly Americans. So it's one of the first shows that we did the entire thing from beginning to end, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Does that put a lot more pressure on you to do it that way, or is it like it better?
It's a more pressure, a little. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, it's just more volume. You know what I mean? So just things get bigger. And the important thing to me has always been, however big we get, to retain our artistic integrity. You know, maybe as corny as that sounds, it's important to me, you know, that like we're not ever just churning it out for the money. And that's really true. I'd be a lot richer if I did that.
Right.
But we tend to like really focus on one project at a time and, you know, really keep our creative stamp on it. So, you know, the important thing when you get bigger, when you're doing like a whole half an hour show versus say like little 5 minute cartoons for Wonder Showzen, and, you know, it's all about, you know, making sure you're being strategic about where you're putting, your focal points, right? It's like, make sure that, you know, you have like the important people are at the top the triangle, right? Like making sure that the designs all look consistent and that, you know, the backgrounds, like they really feel like New York City and like all those kinds of things. And, you know, you don't want to dilute something because you get too big, right? So that's the main strategy, is just always to like retain a singular vision to the show, no matter how big the team gets. I think that's always the biggest challenge.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. So you have then, is your team also writing the script on that as well? Is your team doing all of that part? Do you do the voiceovers? Do you record them all there as well? Is everything happening in your studio?
It depends on the show. We don't record in our studio. We usually work with a studio called Great City in Manhattan. They do pretty much all our shows. So the recording of the audio is like the only thing we don't do. I mean, we do it sometimes, but not very much. But yeah, everything else soup to nuts. I mean, it depends on the show. You know, like you know, often, you know, they have outside writers and they'll have a writing team, or we'll set up a writing team, or maybe we will write it in-house. You know, like Superjail is a show that we wrote that whole show in-house. The show that we did recently, Death Hacks, that was a show we wrote completely in-house. So it definitely varies from show to show. You know, it all depends on, you know, who are, you know, typically the creator of the show is the head writer. You know what I mean? Like in television, you know, the writer is the king. Right. In movies, it's the director. Right. In television, it's the writer. So it's really up to the writer. So if the creator of the show says, like, I have a team out in L.A. and I'm really happy with that team, well, that's where we want to do it, then that's where we do it. If they say, oh, we want to do it in your studio with your artist, then we do it that way. So it all sort of depends on the show for that. But we do it in any number of ways. But I think if the question is, like, how much you do the studio, from, you know, scripting all the way through final delivery, edit, composite, drawing, everything we can do here at our studio. Wow,
that's awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
All in Brooklyn. See that?
All in Brooklyn. And when we went to Brooklyn, we opened our studio in 99. Everyone said we were completely insane, said, why would anyone open a business in Brooklyn? Right. No one would ever go to Brooklyn. No one likes Brooklyn. People like Manhattan. Don't go to Brooklyn. And then it was shortly after that, man, it became a real boom. And nice. We were proud to be ahead of that. And honestly, being in Brooklyn, you know, obviously there's a huge creative community. It's a great neighborhood. It's got a great vibe there. And, you know, it's also like we're a little bit outside of the city. So, like, not many executives come over to check on what we're doing.
That's a good idea.
So we can sort of do our thing a little bit, which is nice, which doesn't happen when you're in Midtown. I'm a big Brooklyn fan, and I've been very proud to run a business in Brooklyn for 21 years, for sure.
If I ever hear that you're moving the studio to a really remote location, I'll know you're working on something really
something really subversive. Yes, that could happen.
Augenblick Studios is now in Kabul.
Yes, that's the clue in. Yeah.
So there's another project that you worked on, which is, again, very different from anything else, which is Losers on Netflix.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
A documentary series. And the thing that I really like about the concept is, instead of taking a series of very successful people, you've taken a series of people who have used losing in pretty grandiose ways,
yeah,
as a motivation to show that, you know, it's okay to lose sometimes. And what a perfect time to talk about that in general.
We're all losers now.
Yeah, I just feel like there's one specific loser you should really show these to right now that can really, really use it.
That's funny.
But it was really such a different take. The animation in there is well done too, but there's a lot of old footage that you kind of use, yeah, and mix in there. It's how did that one come about to make you want to do something that different?
I mean, that was another cool project. And yeah, it's interesting when you do animation, like I said, for 21 years, it's funny the themes you see and that sort of are you know, mainstays. And you know, underdogs tend to be a theme of our shows. And, you know, so when they came to us with Losers, this was a show that, you know, it was already created and was shooting when they came to us. And they just needed us to do the animation. So that was based on our relationship with a company called First Look. They did a show called The Nib with us. We did, it was a political cartoon show. And they came to us with this and they said, look, we have this documentary series that we're doing and it's called Losers. And every episode is completely different, but it's about some huge loser in the world of sports. And some episodes are funny, some episodes are sad and tragic, and some are just thrillers and terrifying. So, you know, can you illustrate that? And we were happy to. And look, it's I tend to do comedy, and it tends to be dark comedy. So in this case, you know, I like flexing my muscles, and I love documentaries. I probably watch more I watch horror and documentaries probably more than anything else. And, you know, being able to be a part of a documentary series was a dream. And, you know, they came to us. There was the showrunner of the show already was an illustrator himself. So he had the style in place, which is this very realistic, very illustrative, very painterly style. So for us, it was just, you know, being true to that style and being respectful to the stories was really important because, you know, much like Headspace, here's a situation where the worst thing we could do is be funny sometimes, right? Because when somebody's opening their heart about the worst day of their lives, you got to be careful not to be funny because animation tends to be funny, right? So when we were doing Losers, sometimes you do something and it would look kind of funny and you'd be like, no, polish that, man. This is a serious moment, you know what I mean? So yeah, so Losers was great. So we did, a bunch of episodes of that. And really it was, I think for that one, it was about being respectful to the stories and also to the tone of every episode. Because like I said, it's a real, it runs the gamut of storytelling, you know, with those episodes. So yeah, that was another one that I was very proud of.
Yeah, very cool. So yeah, I want to just circle back to Headspace again one more time.
Yeah.
And just remind everybody again, you can check out Headspace Guide to Meditation on Netflix right now. Go watch that. And I'm really, really excited to see what's coming up next from you. And this Teenage Euthanasia, just when the title makes you laugh, it's a really, really good sign. You know,
Euthanasia is the name of the teen girl. That's the heart of the show. But people call her,
may or may not be dead.
Yes. Her name is Euthanasia, but they call her Annie. Sure. Yes, you're going to see some pretty exciting things. We have a lot of really, really exciting things happening in 2021. There's a few things I can't announce yet that you're going to see. There may be some things that surprise you. Yeah, there's some exciting stuff coming out. I also want to say that our new show, Death Hacks, that just came out, you can watch that on Snapchat. That's something I'm very proud of. That's a show that I created and stars Thomas Middleditch and Kristen Schaal. And it's basically like a YouTube life hack show for dead people, for and by dead people. And if you go to deathhacks.com, you can check that out. And yeah, there's just a lot of things happening. And you know, as nightmarish of a year it's been, the silver lining is that animation is very, very busy, and we're very happy to make cartoons for people to watch.
That's awesome. And there's no better time than now, not only for the meditation, but just to make us laugh. You know, people need that more than ever right now.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, no, I'm really excited for everyone to check out Headspace on Netflix. And it's going to be a different experience with animation, and I think a Netflix show, and it's definitely something that you should check out.
Aaron, I saw that Governor Cuomo wrote you a letter in August.
Thank he did. You. I think I might even have it here. I keep it in my wallet. Hold on. Look at this. I actually have it.
Oh, how
look cool. at this. He gave us a plaque that we crushed COVID-19 because we did a really cool cartoon with the Tribeca Film Festival and with the mayor's office. And it was an animation that was spreading the word about wearing masks. And obviously I'm a New Yorker and I love New York and I care about New York very deeply. And I've been very happy to do that. And we actually just did another one that just came out, which is about, you know, all about the holidays and about staying safe. And that just came out. And that was by the World Health Organization and YouTube. And you can see that as well.
I think I saw that actually.
Yeah, you might have. It's YouTube, so it should play every time you want to watch something else. It should play, and then you see it.
Now, how can I get my show to do that? That's what I'm looking for.
Get it animated.
Yeah. Yes, I know. Animated.
Yeah. So, Franco, you have Aaron for a few more minutes. Anything else you I know you've been jonesing. Anything else you want to ask him?
Two things. It's not really an ask, but it's just, I think one of my favorite things that you've ever worked on is Ugly Americans, just because of the pigeon people. My friend Peter, and I, who Rob has met, would go around in college just saying, "Suck my balls," like over and over to each other all the time. So it's probably, of all the things that I can say, like I still think about and will still text them from time to time, that's one of them.
For anyone that doesn't know, Ugly Americans, it was creatures and all these weird monsters. So he's talking about the man birds. Mm-hmm. They were half man, half bird. So they looked like birds, but they had the bodies of a human man nude, and they would sit in trees and defecate on people. But it was a full human defecation.
Right.
So, yes. And that was their call, was they would say, "Suck my balls."
Suck my balls.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is what the subways look like now.
Right, pretty much.
It's true.
When you said man bird,
come true.
I thought of de Blasio right away. So, sitting in a tree and shitting down on us.
Yes. A lot of our shows are very prescient. They tell the future. So, yes, we foresaw all of these things.
Yeah. Honestly, I can't. One quick question that I do have is, if you could do Wonder Showzen again, do you think that it would be more insane now in the current state of the world than it was in, the early 2000s?
I don't know. I mean, it's. I think everyone's had the challenge with entertainment this year that you can't be more insane than the headlines. I mean, there is nothing more insane than the things you see out the window and on CNN, right? So I don't know. Maybe it was because it was a fairly quiet time that we were able to do such subversive material that felt so refreshing to see. I don't know, or maybe not. Maybe we could out crazy the crazy. I don't know. I'm not sure, but maybe we'll see it someday. Who knows?
Hey, here's hoping one day. Here's hoping that comes back one day.
Yeah, everybody, write to MTV. Tell them you want Wonder Showzen again.
I don't know if a show like that could even air these days.
That's true.
maybe not on MTV anymore. I feel it's mostly reality now.
Yeah, you have to do that. I from what I've heard, Trey Parker and Matt Stone deliver the shows literally minutes before they air.
True.
On purpose.
just
for that reason.
The definitely the danger of doing subversive material is eventually it does always normalize. Yeah. Right? The craziest things become pretty normal all of a sudden, right?
Yeah. So especially now.
Especially now.
But Aaron, hang on one second before we go. I'm just going to wrap it up. Just stick around after the ending. But I want to thank you again for joining us. You can follow Aaron as well as anything coming from Augenblick Studios at Augenblick NYC on Twitter. He also has a gorgeous website that has tons of different clips of all of their work. And it was a pleasure to have you on. I'm really looking forward to what you do in the future. And I want everybody to check out, again, Headspace Guide to Meditation.
This was great. Thank you so much, Rob, Franco, Lori. This was really a lot of fun. I appreciate
it. Thank you, Aaron.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
It's 2021. We made it. We did it.
We made it. All right. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Awesome. I am Rob Sprantz.
I'm Franco Del Valle.
I'm Lori Levine.
Later, motherfucker.